Is everyone biased in some way, or is it possible to be 100% unbiased? Is that even a useful question to focus on? It's obvious that the concept of bias is on the minds of people trying to make sense of all the contradictory information on nutrition. We see it all over social media, and we see it here in the comments as well. Depending on the viewer, we're either meat shills or anti-meat, members of the carnist cult or vegan propaganda, biased in favor of eggs or against them. And we're funded by dairy, in the pocket of Big Pharma, and sponsored by the fishing industry. Apparently, we're getting checks from everybody. I should be taping this on my private jet. The truth is, we actually decline all commercial partnerships and deals, but that's not the point. First, let me say, these reactions are actually a good sign, as far as I'm concerned, that some people care enough about nutrition to have strong feelings about it. Disagreement is good. Our enemy is indifference. The fact that most Westerners are on what Dolly Parton calls the seafood diet. I see food and I eat it. And to be completely honest, most viewers seem to think we're unbiased. Of course, that could just mean they have the same bias as me, so they see me as unbiased. So if this bias thing is so subjective, so in the eye of the beholder, is it even useful? Does it even help us figure things out? And is there a more powerful tool we can use? I remember when I first started trying to figure out nutrition, the effect of different foods on health. Back then, a lot of the YouTube channels and podcasts weren't around yet, so in a way, my job was easier. Less noise. So I did the only thing I knew how to do. I started reading studies. About a month in, I thought I had it all figured out, because everything seemed so clear, so black and white. They have a name for that. Dunning-Kruger. And at that time, whenever I heard somebody say something that didn't align with the little evidence I had seen, I remember thinking, how can this person say this? The evidence is so clear. Maybe this person is just biased. Then something really interesting happened. As I kept learning and reading more, sometimes I would find evidence to support some of those views I had labeled as biased. And I realized, oh, that guy 3 months ago was actually right. Not always. Sometimes people are just plain wrong and there's a lot of confusion on the internet. But sometimes that happened. And I had a light bulb moment. That when I wrote somebody off as biased, oftentimes there was more a reflection of my bias than theirs. As a result of that experience, two things happened. First, I instituted a rule for myself that if somebody makes a claim I disagree with, and if they show evidence for it, like actual robust evidence, a peer-reviewed study, if I'm not familiar with the study, I have to read it. I've kept that up for years. Anytime somebody tweets a study at me, or even here on the comments, I don't see every comment, unfortunately, but if I happen to catch it, and if there's a study that I'm not familiar with it, I make sure I open a tab on the browser. Sometimes that means I have 40 tabs open on my browser and it feels like I'm never going to get to it, but eventually I do get to it and I look at them all. That rule has been an enormous pain in my butt, but it has taught me immensely. Now, sometimes the study is not robust, or sometimes I'm familiar with it already. Sometimes the person misunderstood it. But sometimes it's a strong study that changes my perspective, and I adapt my views based on it. That's happened many times over the years. And the second thing that happened was that because I forced myself to look at the evidence, and because that process a lot of times threw in my face that the bias was actually mine, I naturally stopped labeling people as biased and unbiased. I didn't realize this at the time, but recently going through the comments and thinking about this, I realized that type of categorization is not even part of my internal dialogue anymore. In fact, if you go through the videos where we fact-check somebody, we've made a couple of those over the years, I'm pretty sure I never called somebody biased. And I certainly never dismissed a view or a claim strictly based on a bias or on what the person eats or where they get their funding from. Not once. And we've looked at some outlandish claims. I don't even remember using the word bias ever on this channel before today. I could be wrong, but I don't remember using it once in like 130 videos that we've published. It's just not something that guides my thinking anymore. What replaced it was the concept of totality of evidence. And in fact, if you go through those fact checks, you'll see that what we try to do consistently is compare the claims made to the available evidence. Now, I know some of you are throwing yourselves in the air and saying, ah, but you can find a study to support any view you want. And it's in choosing the studies, that's where the bias comes in. Well, that's why we don't talk only about showing some evidence, but rather about totality of evidence, or at least balance of evidence. Crucial distinction. I know this can sound slippery and kind of subjective, but it's a lot less than it seems. So here are some real-world examples. One obvious one is painting an entire category of foods with a broad stroke. For example, all fat is bad. The only way to eat healthy is a low-fat diet. I just saw that like 2 days ago on a website. Right? So we could dismiss that as anti-fat bias, but it doesn't tell us zilch, because maybe I have a pro-fat bias and the website is actually right. We know that's incorrect because the balance of evidence shows plenty of benefits of specific types of fat. Nuts, seeds, fatty fish, avocado, olives are some of the healthiest foods you can eat, and they're pretty fatty. And yes, liquid vegetable oil, also overwhelmingly beneficial outcomes in the literature, unlike what the internet will tell you. So saying that all fat is bad does not reflect the balance of evidence. Not even close. That doesn't mean you can't eat a low-fat diet if you want. Of course you can. We'll come back to this in a second. But we need to be able to separate personal preference from scientific fact if we're going to have any type of adult conversation about this. It's the exact same thing with all carbs are bad. Some people still believe that. I still see that sometimes on social media. Completely contradicted by the balance of evidence. Whole carbohydrates and refined carbohydrates have vastly different outcomes. Another one. Every time we make a video talking about meat or dairy or eggs, somebody will complain that we're giving people license to eat toxic foods because all animal foods are toxic. First of all, we're not the Supreme Court. Discussing science is not allowing or disallowing anything. Now, regarding this idea that all animal products are toxic, some people will dismiss that as vegan bias, and some people will hit back and say, no, actually, it's the carnist bias of our society that doesn't even allow us to see it. And we hit an impasse, and we've learned nothing about what is factual. Because obviously, if we dismiss one person's views on nutrition based on what they choose to eat, the logical extension is we have to dismiss everyone's views, because everyone needs to make a dietary choice, and that could be construed as some kind of bias. Unlike this slippery, ambiguous stuff, the evidence is actually quite clear. Again, we can look, among many others, at the obvious example of fish. The outcome evidence on the health effects of eating fish is overwhelmingly positive, even when we compare it to other specific foods one-on-one. Now, some people will argue, but the environmental impact of fishing and the ethics of fishing are horrible. Yeah, they are. We covered all of that in the Seaspiracy reaction video. We went over the environmental issues. I even explained that I personally avoid fish and seafood mainly for that sustainability aspect. So we can state things clearly. The health data shows positive outcomes of fatty fish, like salmon, for example, a couple times a week. We don't need to shoehorn the science to fit our personal views. It's not honest, and it doesn't really work long term. Okay, another big one. Fudging with risk factors. We see that a lot. That big risk factor over there that applies to everybody, it doesn't apply to me. That same low-fat website that I mentioned earlier claimed that triglycerides don't matter. As long as you're on that low-fat diet and your cholesterol is really low, you can let your triglycerides go sky high, doesn't matter. We could call that a low-fat bias. Low-fat diets tend to lower cholesterol and can sometimes raise triglycerides, so it certainly sounds convenient that the risk factor they don't have is the important one and the one they happen to have is the one we can ignore. But labeling something as biased doesn't help me. Maybe he's biased and right. Or maybe I'm the one with the bias and I can't see the low-fat truth. The reason that claim is wrong is because it's not supported by the evidence. We can have low cholesterol and still have residual risk. Plenty of studies show that. And triglycerides can be a reflection of VLDLs, which are a type of particle that is also atherogenic, also raises cardiovascular risk. So ignoring sky-high triglycerides just because our cholesterol is low is not a good idea. And the same with low carb, except it's usually turned upside down, right? As long as your trigs are low, ignore your LDL cholesterol. Sometimes they'll throw in HDL cholesterol. As long as your triglycerides are low and HDL cholesterol is high, you can ignore your LDL cholesterol. Is that a bias? Who cares? It's inaccurate because you can have low triglycerides and high HDL cholesterol and still be at higher risk. Plenty of examples of that have been shown in the literature. Plus, all of these metrics of lipids are indirect indicators anyway. We've covered all of that before in detail. So it's all about epistemological consistency. Do we apply the same rules across the board? Or do we set the bar really low for ideas we love and much higher for ideas we don't like? We see this all the time. Just last week, we published a video on alcohol. The conclusion could be seen as somewhat unpopular. The data indicated that any level of regular intake could be harmful. But there was no resistance. Everybody pretty much accepted the evidence and the conclusion. And yet, we make a video about cholesterol or ApoB, and everybody throws themselves in the air. Everybody's outraged. And yet, we have more evidence for ApoB than for alcohol. All right, let's wrap up with some actionable tips. How can you use all of this to protect yourself and make sense of things? Two levels, all right? Two levels of investment. Level one, when you're sitting online looking at some content, it could be a blog, it could be a podcast, it could be a YouTube video, look at the references. Scroll down, pause the video. I do this all the time. Before I even watch the video, I pause it, I go to the description, and I check the references because it tells me more than 10 minutes of watching somebody talk. You don't even need to read the studies. Just click the links and take a quick look. First of all, does it have references? If it doesn't, that's not a good start. You can't even begin the conversation. Are the studies in humans or mice? Are the studies observational or interventional? You can tell often by the title, if not by that little blurb in the beginning called the abstract. Is it an isolated study or is it a meta-analysis that looks at a body of evidence? That takes you less than 30 seconds, and as you go through content, it will teach you so much. You will go from, I'm watching a video by so-and-so where he's saying XYZ, and I like it or not, and I trust him or not, and he seems biased or unbiased, to this person made this claim, he showed this piece of evidence, and it supports his argument or not. That is a colossal mindset shift. It instantly puts you in like the top 1% of people watching this type of content, and it immunizes you against misinformation and just general confusion. Level two, for those who are a bit more gung-ho and want to invest a little bit more energy, it's basically my rule. Every time you hear somebody make a claim that you disagree with, look at their evidence. Go through it in a bit more detail and make some brief notes, two or three lines. Maybe title of the paper, main findings, experimental approach. That's good for starters. This will seem like a huge drag. Much more tempting to just apply the bias label and dismiss the view. With one word, we get rid of it and we avoid all this work. Plus, we're always right. If somebody disagrees with us, they're just biased. Done. But by doing this over time, I promise you, you will learn so much that in 6 months, you'll look back, you'll be stunned how far you've come. What are your thoughts on all this? Do you agree, disagree, or did you think the whole thing was biased, maybe? Let me know your thoughts below. Take care. See you next time. Bye.